Laurent Duvernay-Tardif, bonjour.
Laurent Duvernay-Tardif, hello.
Votre parcours est vraiment exceptionnel.
You've had a really exceptional career. In 2014, you were the first Quebecer in 15 years to be picked by the NFL draft. You were the first active NFL player to get a medical degree. And with the Kansas City Chiefs, you won the Superbowl in February 2020. A U.S. Daily calls you the most interesting man in the NFL. So how would you describe the path that has led you here? Well, not like that. I think I see myself more as someone who's been really privileged, as someone who wasn't afraid to somewhat naively leap into something. The NFL is the biggest sports league in the world, something you don't necessarily realize as a Quebecer. I launched into that with a lot of passion. I also got lucky. I was very committed. Medicine became more and more important in my life. And sometimes, you know, there are different ways of seeing the last 9 years in the NFL. You were born on the South Shore in Montreal, in Mont-Saint-Hilaire. So what was your family like? What were the values in your family? Well, self-confidence and determination, but not necessarily in a competitive way. They gave us so many experiences to my sister and I. We sailed a lot. My parents were both CJIP teachers. We traveled. We saw vineyards. We saw different regions. We went sailing. We met different cultures. We were interested in people. And those trips really did a lot for me, and they still do. Then my parents opened a bakery, which was totally different. My family clearly is not very typical. I say it as a joke that I'm the least good athlete in my family. My sisters are incredible athletes. So are my parents. Your parents clearly were very committed people. They were committed socially as well. They were good planners, and your paternal grandfather was a minister in René Lévesque's first government in 1976. In a few minutes, we'll talk about what foundation your life had. Do you believe that engaging in society is something that's part of your family's DNA? Oh, yes, absolutely. Commitment to move things forward and also to give back. That's often the message that I have for young people and less young people in corporate environments. It's that we're truly privileged, and we owe it to recognize those privileges and to give back. You know, with medicine, with our sailing trips, I had so much opportunity to engage with people from different cultures. And in football, you're in a locker room with people from all parts of the U.S. You have a common ambition. You all want to win that match, but you really have to reconcile differences, different political views, different religions. You need to forge a team spirit
impossible d'accomplir, ouais.
So that you can accomplish what you just couldn't individually. And through all that, in 2010, you were studying medicine at McGill University, Montreal. And in 2014, you were picked for the NFL draft. So how did you manage to balance studying medicine at McGill and moving ahead in the NFL? Well, it was balanced, but really medicine was always plan A for me. In my studies at CJIP and in high school, I worked really hard to get the grades that I would need to get into med school. And it's a perfect balance between science and the interaction with people, people from all kinds of backgrounds, people from all walks of life. But they're hard to reconcile. At McGill, I was told that I could not do both, study medicine and play football. I listened to them. I stopped playing football when I started med school in 2010, but 2 months later, I went back to see my coach because I really missed that framework that wasn't just a huge outlet. It was also a way to compartmentalize and separate something from my studies. Medicine was the priority, but I played football, and when I was picked for the draft, I needed to talk to the faculty to find a way of building a schedule that would make it possible for me to do both. I also needed a coach that would understand that for me to be the best possible player on the field, I needed to be strongly and deeply anchored in a different thing altogether. I think I was a better football player because of medicine. And, you know, what was the most difficult thing to do at McGill was to reconcile the schedules as a student athlete. And in the NFL, the hardest thing was to make the transition between being in a stadium with 80,000 people, having a whole team focused on you, coach, trainer, physiotherapist, nutritionist, and then you go back to med school, you're a med student again, you're at the bottom of the food chain of the medical hierarchy, and then you're part of the team that is there to help and focus on the patient. So that transition was very difficult for me. But it was also the point at which I would learn the most, you know, transitions, new plans, new things, new interactions, and it is those interactions that make us grow. I had those interactions in 2014, 15, 16, until we won the Superbowl, basically. And then, you know, I had to go from winning the biggest sports event in the world to going back to working as a doctor. Yep, the Chiefs won the Super Bowl, and we can only imagine what a massively emotional moment it was. So that's over 3 years ago now. So what do you remember of it? Oh, I can still feel the hairs rise, goosebumps. I still get goosebumps. It's huge pressure. Every day you have to perform. You have no choice but to make the sacrifices needed to go all the way. Even if you're one out of 32 teams, there's every chance you'll get injured along the way and not make it. But you don't look at that. You look at your goal. We got to the Super Bowl gradually. We didn't make the playoffs the first year. The second year we did. Then we won the division, then the conference. And finally, we won the Super Bowl. I think that was the biggest team achievement of my career. My biggest individual achievement of my career was the day that I walked on stage at McGill and was awarded my medical degree. That was my biggest personal achievement, and the Super Bowl was the ultimate team achievement. You even wanted the title of doctor on your jersey. Yeah, absolutely. That was hugely important because, you know, I walked a path that few people do, and to be able to do that, you need a vision. And for me, running down the tunnel in Kansas City, and I was Dr. Duvernay-Tardif. That is what motivated me when I had to do night rounds while studying and then be on the field at 8 a.m. for training. That is what kept me going. That is what kept me going when things got really tough. Football is one of the only sports where, you know, I don't touch the ball. It's through the performance of others. It's through the team's collective performance that we become defined. You know, every person on the field, every position on the field plays a different role, and I don't carry the ball. And you need to be able to face the season, face obstacles with a vision of succeeding together. When you won the Super Bowl, you became our national pride, our Laurent Duvernay-Tardif. Did you have the impression that your life was no longer yours? No. No, I never did. When you move away from football, you realize that there is some futility to it because it is, after all, a game. You know, basically, we're trying to move a ball across a field of grass, and it is a game. You know, being able to play a game for a living is quite a privilege, yes. And the pandemic gave me a platform. Because I became famous through football, I have a platform to help and to pass messages. My cause is health, promoting a health-oriented message. That's the mission that I decided I needed to have, and I want to use my platform properly to promote world health. It's clear that health really is your plan A, the fact of being a doctor, so much so that after winning the Super Bowl in February of 2020, that's when the pandemic hit, you decided to work in a long-term care home in Quebec. Why? I think I felt powerless, like so many people, so many Quebecers. You know, we'd won as a team the most important sports event with 150 million viewers, and then you think, why? Why? In March and April, we were being encouraged to help on the front lines, and without asking too many questions, I just raised my hand, especially, or even though I should say my NFL contract has a clause that indicates I shouldn't be, well, stipulates really, I shouldn't be engaging in high-risk activities, but I wanted to give, and there was something, in a sense, beautiful in the disorganized chaos of the first months of the pandemic to see that people who wanted to help their fellow human beings would go into environments that were certainly not safe. It was important to me to be part of that movement because, yes, football is important, but when I looked in the mirror when I got up in the morning, it was and must be important to make decisions that are in line with how we are and what we feel, what our values are. After that experience, you decided not to play the following season in the NFL. I think you said in an interview that this was one of the most difficult decisions you ever had to make. And it was a decision that surprised a lot of people. Do you believe that the decision you made then will define you for the rest of your life? Well, it was symbolic of the kind of person I wanted to be. The NFL is wonderful. It was an immense privilege. And, you know, it seemed logical to go back because every year that goes by, that's fewer years available to play football. And you drop in the draft if you don't go. But there were tens of thousands of cases. And in the U.S., we'd have to travel by plane to go to different cities, which are pandemic hot zones, and become transmission vectors ourselves and all that to play football. Something in that didn't make sense to me, especially after the 12 weeks I spent on the front lines when I saw how much people were suffering and how much healthcare personnel were taking risks, to what extent they were sacrificing themselves to look after other people. I was ready to go because in my head I was going, you know. If you don't go to your training, it's a break of contract. So I called the only person at the NFL who knew my story, Andy Reid, and I said, I don't think it makes sense for me to play this year. It's very touching, in a sense, to understand that he supported my decision because he was expecting it. He supported me individually, and he also supported me in the media when I announced I wouldn't be playing in the 2021 season. My teammates also supported me. You know, that's real team spirit. Somebody who's on the offensive line and leaves and his teammates support his decision. even though we were
the
Super Bowl champion holders at the time. We were the Super Bowl title holders. So you aren't under contract with any particular team at the moment. Are you still open to playing? You know, it's hard to say no. There's not much in the world that can beat that feeling of just going above and beyond yourself, physically making decisions in difficult and high-pressure environments in football and medicine. Football is like chess, and in some ways, medicine is puzzle-solving too. So if the phone rings, it's hard to say no. But the biggest downside for me is that after 9 years, the risk of injury is much, much higher. And also, because I'm not part of a team during training, I reduce my chances of being picked, and I reduce my chances of remaining injury-free. Well, you still look pretty fit. The other passion you have is your foundation. In 2017, you and your spouse founded the Laurent Duvernay-Tardif Foundation. All young people in the foundation came to see us today. The foundation aims to maintain a balance between sports, arts, and study in students between grades 5 and 6. Why that mission? Well, for some time now, we've been talking a lot about the concept of balance. And I knew that having some anchor, a foot in a different area altogether, helped me stay grounded. It can be difficult to motivate children and help them to succeed in school. And I have no doubt that the arts and school are very powerful, not just to keep you healthy, keep your cardiovascular system healthy, but to help kids stay in school and help them succeed in their education. It's a more holistic approach, and that's the foundation's mission. The foundation's been there for 5 years now, and now we're on the ground in schools as a extracurricular activity. So we engage kids once a week in sports and arts. We work with qualified mediators who help them discover new sports and new artistic practices. This isn't crafts. This is more creativity, pushing boundaries. And kids sometimes say, why, we can do that, like clay sculpture, visiting contemporary artists' works, and we're asking them to see if they can do that kind of thing. And you can see the sparks flying. You can see how excited that get. We're not focused on performance, but on discovery. And that is my vision. What I know about science has shown me that kids who do sports and arts are, and those who engage in team sports have more self-esteem, more self-confidence, and a far better chance of succeeding academically. So that makes a lot of sense to me, but science bears me out. So that's my mission. Why kids in grades 5 and 6? Because that is when we can have the greatest chance of having an impact that will persist, that will endure. There are a lot of extracurricular activities available, but kids with talent or kids with indicators that are associated with dropping out, like, for example, socioeconomic circumstances. So we want to get there before the dropout happens. We want to get them interested before it happens. Is it your parents that helped you get through all this? Well, you know, of course, absolutely. If we look at the sport, the athlete-student ecosystem in Quebec, it's very, very performance-focused. But there are ways of performing, and it can be arts, it can be theater, it can be music. The whole issue of facing adversity and overcoming it is extremely enriching. just when I think about medicine, you know, in medicine, you can't afford to fail. You need the grades. You need everything. At the top level, you need to be top in everything to just get into med school. But once you're in med school, you don't find things necessarily going your way. So if you haven't found ways before that of learning how to deal with pressure, it's very difficult. There is a lot of depression and suicide in the medical profession, relatively speaking. So life experience that you can acquire outside that straight line to medicine, which we chose, but it mustn't exclude everything else, because when it allows other things in, you don't define yourself just as a football player, not just as a doctor, not just as anything. You are many things. And that helps you not only manage stress, but how to deal with problems and failure. You said that there's a high-pressure, performance-focused environment in sports. We've seen parents yelling in the bleachers because they want their kids to be ending up in a professional team like you did. Do you think that sport can become toxic? Oh, absolutely. There's a paradox in sports. I'm a professional athlete, so I'm a sort of pedestal because I'm an example of physical activity. But what have I done in the past 9 years is burn the candle at both ends. I'm at much higher risk of having a knee replacement or a hip replacement. You know, I have type 2 obesity. So at some point, sport stops being healthy. It's one thing to choose to take those risks when you're a professional athlete and you're compensated for those risks. But for a young person who's learning to skate before learning to run and who's doing really specialized skating lessons in summer, what message are we giving to kids? We have to think about that. And we're seeing more and more data emerging to show that a young person who tries different extracurricular sports will find the one that is a real passion, the way that I did. So in 5 years, you'd like your foundation to have a presence in about 100 Quebec schools. What will it mean? What will it take for you to say mission accomplished for the foundation? Well, the foundation is really just starting out. What we needed was a program that made sense and that was well aligned with extracurricular activities in schools. We worked with the Chagnon Foundation and other major stakeholders to come up with a program that would be efficient, cost-effective, look for the right young people, put in good, solid training objectives. The recipe is there now. And fortunately or unfortunately, it's a question of money now. We need to get the funding, and that is my mission, to use the platform football has given me to get those funds, raise awareness, be it public funding or private funding, to move things forward, because at present we just don't have enough. Our young people need to move more, to create more, and now with that project, what we need is to achieve more of our ambition. So for the next couple of years, I'll be using all my energies and means to move it up. You're a doctor. Tell me about the healthcare system in Quebec. There have been reforms. We're hearing that it's cracking on all sides. How do you describe it? I think the healthcare system we have in Quebec and Canada is a tremendous source of pride. I've lived in the U.S. for 9 years. The inequalities have a tremendous impact on health. So here we have a fantastic foundation on which to build, and we also have a good foundation to work on prevention. Many studies show how cost-effective and efficient it is to invest in prevention to prevent chronic diseases like hypertension. So if it is cost-effective economically, and if you increase quality of life, and if you end up saving money, we might end up needing to pay less for health in 10 or 15 years if we focus on prevention. We need to have courage, and I'd like to work on that. Well, I think you would make a fantastic Minister of Health. Your grandfather was in politics. Do you think you might be tempted to go into politics? I'm 32.
Vous avez le temps.
J'ai le temps, puis je pense que j'ai beaucoup de bagages.
Maybe one day, but I have time. And I have a lot to learn. I'm giving myself time. And personally, I have tremendous respect for politicians. And, you know, 7 out of 10 people appreciate them. And the 3 people who don't, well, I need to mature before going into politics. Well, you're already multidisciplinary and you're capable of doing many things, as your career has shown. Are you going to manage or are you involved in managing your parents' bakery? Well, managing the family bakery wasn't necessarily part of my plans. But if your parents tell you they want to retire, and if it's not you, it's going to be someone else, well, we'll see. For me, the bakery is more than just a bakery. It's also 800 people who come in every day to get their dose of comfort. And we can, with the baked goods, convey values and plans. Well, you're a planner and you come from a family of planners. Is there a plan that you have in mind and that you would like to move ahead with? At present, my plan is to find my voice in healthcare and see where I can make the biggest difference, find a cause that will lead me to a point where I can say this will be my legacy. What we're doing on the ground with young people through the foundation, where we're trying to help them balance education, creativity, arts, that is public health to me. But it's only one element. And I think I'd like to find something more holistic that brings together everything that I believe in. And I want to say this is what's going to motivate me for the next 10 years after football. Now, my plan is to think about what that might be. And I hope in a couple of years I'll have a better idea of how to define it and dive in. Laurent Duvernay-Tardif, thank you. We'll continue to see what you do.